My name is Sherry Liu and I am a social worker. This video is about my experience with using the Three Houses assessment tool developed by Nikki Weld. The names of the cases I'm about to talk about have all been changed. One time I interviewed a 7-year-old with a severe speech impediment. No one was able to get any significant information from him, but I thought I'd try using the Three Houses assessment tool where we talk about his house of good things, the house of worries, and the house of dreams together. Since he's 7 years old, I was thinking maybe he could write for me. But as you can see in the House of Good Things, he actually couldn't write. So I asked him, can you draw for me? And he started drawing these two stick figures holding hands. He said that's him and his mom. So I asked, what do you like about mom? He said, I love mommy. She takes me out to play. Okay, what else do you like about mom? He said, I like her smile. And when I tried to ask for other things, he couldn't really expand. So I asked, what do you like about dad? He said, nothing. Then we moved on to the House of Worries. And he started drawing this huge face. And he said, that's dad. Notice his face is actually twice the size of this kid and his mom together. And the face doesn't have any limbs. It made me wonder if this kid sees his dad as very big, scary, and powerful. The kid explained, daddy fight with me, daddy drink. Okay, what does daddy drink? White. Where does daddy drink? Outside. Where are you and your baby brother? Inside. Then I asked, what are some things that makes you worried about mommy? He said nothing. Then we moved on to the house of dreams. This is when he started pointing at the house of worries and he said, no house, that's daddy house. He pointed to the house of dreams and he said, I want my own house, daddy, not here, my own house. So I asked, okay, who do you want to be in your house? Mommy with me, no daddy. Then he started drawing mom, and he started drawing this weird little figure on the left side. He said, get punched in the face. Who got punched in the face? Mommy. Who punches mommy in the face? Daddy. I asked what happened. He said, get in the face. But he couldn't really expand on that statement. Then he said, daddy, shush, mommy. I couldn't get any further statements. Before this interview, the kid's voice wasn't really a factor in decision-making. But by using this tool, I was able to help him express his experience of witnessing violence in his home and his experience of his dad and give this little boy a voice. It was helpful information for all the adults who cared about this child so that we all had a better understanding of his trauma and his needs. And that's the magic of the Three Houses assessment tool. I learned this tool in a training in 2017 by Amy Jaffe, and I have been using this tool since then. I've also been adding my own little twist throughout the years. I find this tool very helpful for kids to feel comfortable when you're interviewing and to feel like you're playing with them, and that brings out so much more information. Another reason I love this tool is that it aligns perfectly with the core practice model and the child family team meetings that we do. If you think about it, for CFTs, we address the family's goals, which matches up to a child's house of dreams. We talk about the strengths, so house of good things, right? And the kids will say what they like about their parents, and I love to include those in the CFTs. It could be daunting for a parent to be feeling like they're not doing anything right, but no, there's so much strength in every family. Even if it's something small, like a kid saying, I love when my mom cooks spaghetti, I make sure to put that in so the parents can be encouraged by the little things that they have done well. Social workers, sometimes when we get to the house of worries, we're telling the families what our worries are. The parents may take it in to a certain degree, but it's completely different when the worries are the kid's direct statement. One time I had this kid who said, I'm worried that when my parents are fighting, my dad might shoot my mom with his gun and my mom's gonna die. The kid's actual thoughts weigh so much more on a parent. And when you get to the scaling questions, sometimes the kids will brainstorm and tell you what specifically they might need the parents to change for them to feel safe. Usually when I interview with this tool, I really try to hype it up. And I say, today we're gonna do this super fun activity together and it's called the Three Houses. In the first house, we'll write all the things you like in your life, and that's the house of good things. In the second house, we'll write all of your worries, and that's your house of worries. And the last house, that's the house of dreams. That's the house you live in if all of your worries disappear. I brought pens and color pencils. You have a choice. Do you want to write it draw it, or do you want me to do it for you? For the House of Good Things, I find that most kids will give you a materialistic thing, like the trampoline in the backyard or their PlayStation. So I usually have to prompt a little bit by asking questions such as, what do you like about mom? What's your favorite memory with dad? A few pointers. I find that a lot of times when kids are coached, they'll tell you nothing in the House of Good Things or worries, but I've encountered kids telling me, in my house of dreams, my mom wouldn't hit me anymore. Or in my house of dreams, my mom wouldn't take this pill. I think it's cocaine because after she takes it, she starts shaking and crying and I think she's about to die. So I have to put her in the bathtub and bring her another pill. Sometimes when you give the kids the freedom to say whatever they want to say, they might not actually touch on the allegation. So what I do is that I'd ask a prompting question. So I might say, I heard something about fighting. What happened? Another resource that you can use is a 10-step investigative interview developed by Thomas Lyon. He uses open-ended questions like, tell me why I came to talk to you. I heard someone may have done something to you that wasn't right. Tell me everything about that. There's actually more questions, so I encourage you to search that really helpful resource on the internet. I find that preparation is very helpful for this tool. I usually determine how many households the kids go to before the interview, and I split the homes. I do that because one time I had a birth parent alleging the foster parent was abusing the kids. So I decided to split the homes into two to assess for both the birth and the foster parent's homes. And when I split the homes, I was able to tell that the kids described the foster home as calm compared to the stress in mom's home. And I'd say at most split the homes into three because after that you start to lose a kid's interest. This is an example of a split home. This is 4-year-old Mary's House of Good Things. She was sexually abused by her birth father, Bob, and she lives with mom and stepfather, John. For the House of Good Things on mom's side, she said, my baby, my love, my daddy, John, mom has curly hair, and everything was great. Then we get to dad's side and she said nothing. And you can see her demeanor changing. She looked really angry. She wasn't smiling anymore. She was short with her responses and she didn't have exaggerated movements anymore. Then we got to the House of Worries. For mom's house, she was back to normal and she said, perfect, mommy silly face. And she started drawing sunshine, a moon, butterflies. She seemed overall happy and said there was no worries at mom's house. But we get to father's house and all of a sudden she became angry. She started drawing with a lot of strength while saying a lot of X's. I don't want to talk about Bob. And she refused to call him anything other than his name. Then we got to the House of Dreams. In mom's house, she said she was already in the House of Dreams. She was drawing sunshine and she seemed happy and back to normal again. Then we got to dad's house and her affect changed again into anger. She said, I'm mad at Bob, I'm mad. I wanted to see if there's any way for her to have monitor visits with dad while feeling safe, but at the thought of visits with dad, she started shutting down and disengaging by drawing the alphabet as a 4-year-old knows it, and pizza. And she refused to engage with me further. This is another House of Worries by another kid, Alex, an 11-year-old girl. Alex was physically abused by her mom, who was also using meth, and her birth father was exposing himself to Alex on video chats. When we talked about the House of Worries at placement with her aunt, she said she was fearful of going back to her mom and dad and losing her baby sister. When we talked about worries at her mom's, she talked about being afraid of being hit, mom being mean, and she started drawing vape pens, cigarettes, and meth pipes. And with dad, she started drawing what she called a pink hairy thing. She said, sometimes it's standing up and sometimes it's slanted, and that's her biggest worry. When I got this training, there was also this concept of a future house, and there's a scaling question where you include the kids in safety planning. But for me, that was a little bit convoluted for me to engage in the field, so I actually created my own scaling question. I have the House of Worries on one side and the House of Dreams on the other. I drew a path in between and I numbered the trees. So I'd ask the kids to draw themselves on this path for each of the house that I split up. I'd ask them after that, what needs to happen for you to move to the next tree? Or what needs to happen for you to move a little closer to the House of Dreams? This is an example of Alex whose father was exposing himself to her. She's at placement with her aunt, where she's already in the House of Dreams. She says she's at a 10 out of 10. When she's with Dad, she's at about a 5.5 out of 10. She says she can move a little closer to the House of Dreams if her dad stopped making her feel uncomfortable by showing her the pink hairy thing. And for Mom, she says she's in the House of Worries right now, and she could move a little closer to the House of Dreams if Mom were nice. But she says she had lost all hope in that. Teenagers, I know what you're thinking. They're too cool for this tool. But what I found is that this tool works well for them as a visual or outline for the interview, so they know what's coming next and when the interview is coming to an end. Sometimes they also use it as a soothing mechanism. Sometimes they're just drawing in the House of Good Things, but they're verbally moving on to the House of Worries. And I'll just let them draw in the House of Good Things while we verbally move on to the next house. What I love about teenagers is that you can be a lot more complex with them. For the House of Dreams, I'd ask them the miracle question from solution-focused therapy. So I asked them, let's say while you're asleep tonight, a miracle happened and everything became perfect. The next day when you wake up, how do you know a miracle happened? What do you see? I interview a 16-year-old, we'll call him Rob. He was a very cool kid, had this black beanie on and this really baggy clothes, and I didn't really think he would engage with me. His mom was using meth, and I asked him the miracle question. He answered, my mom would be in normal out clothing. She'd be in jeans, a t-shirt. She has this really nice long jacket. She'd be cooking ham and eggs. My mom would talk to me randomly. She'd take care of herself, and clothes wouldn't be on the floor. She'd show me she cares about what I'm doing. As social workers, you want to show the parent some hope that the care the kids need are tangible, achievable steps. So I always ask for specifics on how a kid could feel cared for and loved. So I asked, how would your mom show you she cared? And Rob said, it'd be nice if she asked, did you need help with your homework? How's your grades? It'd be nice if she tells me it's bedtime, if she took away my PlayStation to discipline me and make me have a sleep schedule. So Rob would stay up 36 hours straight to play video games. You'd think he was living the life, but he was just craving for structure and for someone to tell him to stop. I think a lot of times we can't figure out how drugs impact a parent's care for a child. But if you use these tools, you can have the child tell you exactly how the drug is impacting them without you making any generalized assumptions. Because for every child, for every family, that effect is going to be just a little bit different. If you don't want to draw the three houses and you'd rather use some templates, they are here on this website. Lastly, I want to leave you with the concept of the power of tiny gains. This is the idea that if you just get 1% better every day, by the end of the year, you'll be about 37% better than you are today. But if you get 1% worse every day, you'll lose most of your value by the end of the year. When I first got this training, I was a little bit overwhelmed because it was this plastic packet of everything I needed to make copies of. There were crayons, but I don't like to bring things to my visits, so it felt like it was a lot to pick up. So what I did was I went into the homes and I started asking the questions, so what's in your house of good things? What's in your house of worries? And I realized, hey, this tool actually really works well. So I started drawing the houses. After each visit, I examined my visits and thought, how can I just get 1% better than the last visit? So I started dividing the homes. I started creating my own scaling question. And it's about that constant 1% improvement. And it took me 3 years of doing it to start bringing color pencils to my visits. That was just so hard for me to do. You can also break this tool into little pieces and just do what you're comfortable with and slowly build on that. There are times when this tool didn't work for me. I could have a pair of twins and it would work for one and not the other. And you can try to be creative and drawing in different interventions and the best research and tools, but sometimes you're doing all the right things and it just doesn't work. When that happens, not if, but when, don't be discouraged. It happens to all of us no matter how strong we are with interviewing. All you can do is to keep growing, keep learning, keep honing in on your interviewing skills, just 1% a day, and hopefully by the end of the year, we'll all be just 37% better than we are today.